More violence in the U.S. over the weekend, but this time stemming from a President Trump rally. Saturday's shooting in Portland, Oregon occurred near clashes between Trump supporters and counter-protesters after a Trump 2020 cruise rally that happened earlier in the day. The shooting victim lost his life. Joining me now from Los Angeles to discuss this is our foreign affairs expert, Lisa Daftari. Lisa, thank you so much for joining me today.
Pleasure.
So, Lisa, can you weigh in on the incident over the weekend? What's the latest update?
Interesting, because I do cover foreign affairs and national security, and, you know, I'm usually looking at parts of the Middle East and, you know, where all the turmoil is, and now it's all here in the United States. The world is looking right here at the United States and probably shaking their heads just like you did right now and wondering, where is this going to go? I mean, 2020 has brought on so much chaos in every sense of the word, in terms of the pandemic, in terms of internal strife here in this country. And we are only getting more scared as we go closer to the election. I mean, what will happen if Trump wins? What will happen if Trump loses? You know, and you look at these rallies that are supposed to be peaceful rallies, and we have gone so far back in terms of what happened to peaceful demonstration, what happened to diplomacy, what happened to, you know, talking it out and really respecting one another. It just has become, you know, pebbles and bam bam, and people using excessive force, looting, rioting, protesting to get their points across. And, you know, it begs the question, what forces are behind these protests and the looting and the rioting, and why are they so organized? Why are they so violent? And why do they have certain politicians backing them, justifying them? This is really unprecedented when you have elected officials justifying, you know, the violence, the looting, the rioting. And, you know, we pray for better days, more peaceful days. But, you know, this has just gone too far.
100%. It's both shocking and heartbreaking. So this man that was shot, he was a Trump supporter, right?
Yes, and he actually was a visible one. I mean, he had a public platform. He was the leader of a pro-Trump group, and, you know, a lot of people mourning his death today, both symbolically and personally. You know, symbolically because he was someone who had dedicated his life to politics, to, you know, defending his candidate and to his political party, and his life should not be taken for that reason. And obviously, you know, as a nation, we mourn this because this is just, it's senseless. It's completely senseless.
Mm-hmm. Now, we're hearing that he was from a group called Patriot Prayer. Are you familiar with that group? What is it exactly?
Yeah, you know, it's one of these pro, you know, it's a right-wing group. I think people in the media will illustrate it as, you know, far-right, radical-right. These are, you know, little descriptive words that they give to groups that they probably don't agree with here in the mainstream media that completely lean left. We're used to that by now. But, you know, again, a group that was probably, you know, less visible to the ordinary person, but to those who are, you know, affiliated with, you know, the GOP and the underground groups, he was someone who was important. And, you know, he had a social media profile, and again, many, many people mourning his death today.
Okay. Now, there have been protests in Portland for over 90 days and nights since the death of George Floyd back in Minneapolis back in May, on May 25th. But right now, it appears that the mayor of Portland and President Trump are clashing. And I think this incident over the weekend kind of came to a head with that.
Yes, and same thing goes for Wisconsin. Yeah. It looks like, you know, leaders are finding themselves in a position where they, if they side with Donald Trump, there's backlash. And if they clash with Donald Trump, well, they're not really seeing an end to this resolution. Donald Trump said in his acceptance speech for the nomination a few nights ago that if these leaders, local or, you know, governors and mayors and such, if they would allow for the federal government to help them, they would take out these protests in a matter of hours. I mean, nobody wants the National Guard coming through their cities. I know here in Los Angeles, we had to have that happen in the aftermath of the Floyd protests. Nobody wants that. But at the same time, nobody wants senseless deaths like this one. Nobody wants, you know, shattered businesses, especially in the aftermath of COVID, when so many people are suffering economically and otherwise. So, you know, I think, it really behooves these leaders to put aside their partisan politics, you know, and say, we want to make this peaceful. We want to put an end to the violence, to the protests. And this is where we live. You know, at the end of the day, it's where you live. You have to love your city, your state, your country. And we're just not seeing that right now.
Yeah, it's heartbreaking. Now, the unrest that we've seen over the past week in Wisconsin and now Portland prompted the president last week to tweet about sending federal law enforcement and the National Guard to Kenosha. And he quoted, so in his tweet, he said to restore law and order. So has this happened, Lisa? And has the National Guard presence been effective?
No, because he's been told that it will make things worse. Exactly what we just said. You know, it's just this kind of resistance to get along with the man sitting in the White House. You know, what are you going to get? A pat on the back by the lefties? You know, it's a time that all leaders came together, left, right, center, and said, we want to restore peace in this country. When Biden came out today and said, I want to make a speech, and the only thing he wanted to do is critique the way that President Trump is handling the protests across the country. And when you think about that, you're like, this guy is running for office as well. You know, why can't he say, I stand in solidarity with President Trump, and left, right, and center, we want to put an end to the violence, because regardless of your political color, you don't want this country to face these kinds of violence. You don't want people to die, because, you know, we all respect each other. Regardless of our political affiliation.
Now, Lisa, some residents in Kenosha say that Trump's visit on Tuesday is all about his reelection, not about healing the community. Others are going even further and say that they're worried Trump's visit may stir more emotions and cause more violence and destruction in the city after several days of peace. So he is scheduled to tour that area. So what's your take on this?
Yeah, the resistance has gone so far to say, well, this is because of his reelection, of course, because anything he does other than sit home until election day will be seen as, you know, working towards the election. You got to look at his record for the past 4 years. What has he done? Has he gone to the scene of hurricanes and, you know, things like that? And he has. I mean, it's unfair to say that he's doing this to be reelected, you know, just like it'd be unfair to say, you know, Biden or Kamala Harris come out with a statement about something because they want to get elected. Of course, that's what they're trying to do. But the president has already been elected. He's already had a track record of showing support, showing solidarity, giving money, giving, you know, coming up with all of these financial, kind of bailouts for the American people during this time of coronavirus. So, you know, it's unfair to say that this is just for the visuals. And, you know, again, it behooves us all as a nation to work together. I mean, he's going to come. Will it stir more violence? Perhaps. But you know what? He's the president of the United States, and he, regardless, represents us all. It doesn't matter what political party you affiliate with. But yeah, we're counting down the days to election day, as you can imagine. I mean, who knows what the future holds and what it'll be like the day after election day, where, you know, everything is so politicized here, you know, from the reaction to COVID, from the response, from the vaccine. No one can believe anything anymore.
And I know. Really, and the way that 2020 is going, it's still like anything is possible at this point, right?
Exactly.
Now, initially, speaking of Wisconsin, initially the media was reporting that Blake was unarmed, but then later it's been determined that he was actually, in fact, armed with a knife. Now, should the media still be treating him like a victim? Because that seems to be what's been happening.
Yeah, you know, 2020 is not the year of facts. It's the year of emotion. And the DOJ came out over the weekend and said, in fact, he was reaching, not only had the weapon, but he was reaching for it at the time that this happened. Look, we can have the conversation that it was excessive use of force. He didn't have to be shot seven times, but the police officer did need to restrain him. He's not a saint, just like, you know, Floyd wasn't a saint. But they're painted out to be that because they represent a very literally black and white picture of what happened. Look, the way that you have people running out and saying defund the police, it would be equivalent to saying defund the hospitals if I saw a bad doctor. Are there bad policemen? Yes. Do they take advantage of the role? Yes. Are there wonderful policemen? More than the bad ones. Many more than the bad ones. And they're not talked about and they're not celebrated. And, you know, ever since this has happened, I walk the streets and if I see a police officer, I say thank you for your service, because more chances than not, that officer has dedicated his life to doing good and has done good. And, you know, we're just living on emotion right now. As you said, if the details of the case change, the investigation brings out new evidence, people aren't willing to listen to it, because right now we're all into proving that the police are bad. There's racism in this country and we are just bad, bad, bad. From professional athletes to celebrities to the mainstream media, that is their agenda. And, you know, it's unfortunate. It's unfortunate because we live in an exceptional nation that does exceptional things and treats its people exceptionally well for the most part. And those few bad examples are taken and highlighted. And now we are just riding on that fury. And it's really unfortunate.
Mm-hmm. So let's turn our attention now to another major topic of 2020, which is coronavirus. So the Centers for Disease Control is facing criticism for changing its guideline recently on who should get tested for COVID-19. They're suggesting that people who have been exposed to the virus but are asymptomatic may not need to be tested after all. But these people are also most likely to spread the virus. So does it make sense to limit who gets tested?
Yeah, this is interesting. The CDC also has come out with some new statistics about how many people actually had the virus and how many of them were actually healthy individuals before the fact, meaning, you know, if they were elderly or had, you know, a list of risky preconditions. And, you know, that the statistic comes down to such a low number, then you ask the question, did it require this shutdown? Did it require us to flatten our economy, you know, around the world? But we're talking here in the United States. When we talk about the CDC, they keep moving the goalposts, and then you really begin to wonder, what am I being told? Am I being lied to? You know, are these political points? Are they trying to raise the number of patients who have died from COVID, or are they trying to reduce the number? Because for both of those scenarios, there would be a political point behind it, depending on which side you're on. Again, very alarming that the institutions that are supposed to protect us and tell us the truth and give us guidelines, particularly to help us navigate through such an uncertain time, are betraying us, are lying to us, are moving the goalposts to a point where we don't have the faith in them that we should have.
Wow. So the CDC also proposed guidelines for distributing a coronavirus vaccine in the U.S. if one is approved for public use. So they've prioritized healthcare workers and essential personnel and vulnerable Americans, such as elderly, being the first to get it. But there are experts who say that poor and minority communities should also be included in this group. What is your take on this, Lisa?
Again, it comes down to, you know, of course, it's because, you know, we are elitists and we are racist. So that's why we chose the healthcare workers to get the vaccine first, not because they're, you know, on the front line of this and are risking their lives day in and day out to fight this vaccine and to help others and help not spread this. This is an asinine argument. And of course, you know, we're having it because it's 2020. you know, anything that is done is questioned and criticized. And, you know, what's the right answer? Obviously, health should get this. And then, you know, in order of minority communities, ironically, were last to get this. They called it the rich man's virus first here in the United States, at least, I can tell you. They call it the rich man's virus first, and then slowly it trickled into the minority communities. And then they said it spread quickly in the minority communities because they weren't being as careful. They were going to work. They were taking public transportation. They were congregating. They either didn't speak English and didn't know the proper guidelines, or they were, again, congregating and taking public transportation. So it was, you know, it spread pretty quickly there. But this in no means is, you know, racist, an issue of racism or elitism or anything else.
Interesting.
Please, 2020.
Yeah. Interesting. So now this is all, of course, dependent on if a vaccine is available. And there seems to be a worldwide race going on to be the first to produce one. I know Canada is now talking about signing agreements with four U.S. drug companies to produce one. So, Lisa, how soon could we see a vaccine?
Well, the FDA came out over the last 24 hours and said they would basically bypass the third round. So basically, when a vaccine wants to be released into the public, there are three trials. So many people on the front lines of this. As you said, there are major drug companies here in the U.S. I know Canada is teaming up with them as well. I know that Israel is on the front line. They have shown a lot of promise with a few of their medical technologies. But the bottom line, again, goes to the conversation as to, you know, do people feel safe jumping on the bandwagon and saying, you know, sign me up for that vaccine? I know many people that I speak to do not want to be injected with any foreign agent, especially right now, particularly since we don't know much about coronavirus. We don't know the long-term implications of the virus. And again, it's 2020, so we'd rather be cautious than anything else.
100%. And with that, we are out of time. Lisa, thank you so much for joining us today. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you, Jeannette.